Welcome. My name is Dawn Salerno. I'm from the Roach Jones Duff House and Garden Museum, and I actually am physically here at the museum broadcasting out there to you all. Thanks for being with us. This is History Happy Hour that you've tuned into. We had one History Happy Hour in person, and then COVID hit. So we've moved all of our programs to an online format, and that's where you'll find us at least through most of May 2021. So I hope you'll join us back here for other History Happy Hours. We have a series of three this spring, and I'm going to drop a few things in the chat, links to our website, links to our guests' websites. So keep an eye on the chat, especially if you wanna check out our future programs. I will also drop into the chat a way for you to make a donation tonight, because we, moving to an online format, we have had only suggested donations as a way of compensating us for all the good and hard work we're doing. So we always appreciate a donation. I will put that in the chat. It's a link to pay online if you'd like to. And then, as I said earlier, a little bit of logistics for this program. When I turn it over to the presenters, they'll each talk at least 15 minutes or so. We expect the program to be about maybe 40 minutes total. We do want to invite your questions at the end, but if you could mute both your mic and your cameras during the talking parts, that way you can see the screen nice and big, you can focus on the speaker, that would be great. And then unmute yourself when we get to Q&A, or if a speaker says, hey, please unmute yourself and speak up, please do so. So those are the logistics. And with that, we're gonna start with, of course, the cocktail part, so that you can go ahead and mix your cocktail at home if you have those ingredients. So I'm gonna introduce our cocktail guru, and that is his moniker. So Jonathan Pogash is the cocktail guru, one of the most premier cocktail consultants and bartenders for restaurants and spirit companies. His signature cocktails can be seen and enjoyed in many of North America's most upscale cocktail lounges and restaurants, and right here at the RJD's programming. With nearly 20 years experience in the hospitality industry, Jonathan shares his insights with the most influential publications from around the world, and he contributes to his unique talents to morning television shows and national radio. Jonathan has appeared on such programs as NBC's Weekend Today in New York and Fox and Friends. And his bio goes on by about double that of Mount. But I will let him take it from here, Jonathan.
That sounds about right. Thank you, Dawn. And so great to see everybody virtually. And I'm very excited to make a cocktail for you virtually here today. And before we get into the ingredients that we'll need for this drink and a little bit of cocktail history, which we need to obviously include for this History Happy Hour, just a brief background on myself. I am Jonathan Pogash. I am founder and owner of The Cocktail Guru. I went to theater school. In upstate New York. I majored in theater, and all I wanted to do after graduating from college was to become an actor. So of course I moved to New York City to try and pursue that. I also got a job in a restaurant, which is my father's urging for me to do so that I could actually make some money. And so my first gig in New York was at the Russian Tea Room, and I worked my way up. I was auditioning still at the time. And actually, ladies and gentlemen, you may recognize me from a circa 2003 National Network Verizon Wireless commercial. Yeah, see, I knew I could see it on your faces. I knew you knew me from somewhere. That's a tongue twister, I could tell. So I made a boatload of cash from that, and I quit my bartending jobs, but that lasted maybe 3 months. And after that, I went full steam ahead. And that's when I created The Cocktail Guru, which eventually became full-time. I met my then fiance, now wife, Megan, who is born and raised in South Dartmouth. So we ended up moving to Dartmouth right around 2009, 2010. And I expanded The Cocktail Guru, and now we are nationwide. But lo and behold, the pandemic hits and I've pivoted, as most others have. And now all we do are virtual events and virtual corporate cocktail hours and happy hours. And these are great. This has been the primary business for us. We have clients like Google and Facebook and Deloitte. We put cocktail kits together for everybody with the liquor and ingredients sent directly to people's houses. So we do these large scale virtual events, and it's been great. And we've been super busy. This holiday season was insane. But enough about that. Let's make a cocktail right over here. I chose the Honey-Apple Martini as the cocktail to make today. It is a variation on a sour style cocktail and a little bit of cocktail history. So dating back to the 1700s, cocktails, especially in the US, were categorized into different families. So probably the most popular family of cocktail or family of mixed drink back then was the punch, okay? People were drinking bowls of punches, ale punch, rum punch, rye whiskey punch. And this was not the sort of what we may think of as punch today, Hawaiian punch and different fruit juices. Definitely not. This was the classic preparation of punch, big blocks of ice, only five ingredients. Actually, the word punch comes from the Hindi word for five, panch, P-O-N-C-H. Traditionally five ingredients, spirit, sugar, water, spice, and citrus. Those were the only elements of a punch drink. Now you remove the spice and you have another category of mixed drink called the sour. And those were very popular, especially moving into the 1800s when we started using ice in our drinks, which we were not doing before. But I'll talk a little bit more about ice because there is a New England connection to why we use ice in drinks. Bar tools, something to set up at your own home bar. If you have this, great. If you don't, maybe you want to run out and get it. So a Boston shaker is what you'll need to shake a cocktail. It's the mixing glass and the mixing tin. You may have seen a three-piece shaker or a cobbler shaker before. It has the built-in strainer, and that's perfectly acceptable. If you don't have either of those, you can actually also use a mason jar or a water bottle to shake your cocktail. And I have the measuring device that we use. This is called a jigger. Okay, if you don't have a jigger, it's okay. You can use a tablespoon. A tablespoon is the equivalent of half of an ounce, and we measure our cocktails in ounces. Oh, I forgot to mention. So locally, I've done the bar programs at, I don't know if you've heard of it, in New Bedford, Cultivator Shoals, not open now, but reopening very soon, actually. DNB Burger, Little Moss, a couple of other places, Not Your Average Joe's, working with Steve Silverstein as well. A couple of the local places I've done, just as a little added plug there. So more tools. So we have our Hawthorne strainer and we have a mixing spoon, knife and cutting board. Want to make sure you have that if you are following along at home. And here are the ingredients for our drink, right? So gin or vodka. I've got my vodka right over here. Okay. Van Gogh vodka. Lemon. This is the citrus element in our cocktail. A drink called a sour has some sort of citrus ingredient and something sweet to counterbalance that citrus. So some other popular drinks that are in the sour family, a cosmopolitan, a whiskey sour, a margarita is a sour, a gimlet is a sour. So there you go. Very popular. Aside from the punch, probably the second most popular family of mixed drinks. Okay. And our apple cider and our honey. That's it. So with this honey, let's go ahead and use our honey first. So I'm going to make a honey syrup or a honey water. So I have some warm water over here. And I have my little jar of honey. What I would recommend doing is doing equal parts warm water and honey. And you're just going to stir that until it dissolves in the water. So I'm adding my honey here and I'm just going to stir it up until it dissolves. I would not recommend using just honey on its own in a cocktail. When you shake it with ice, it will congeal and it will stick to the ice cubes. So you really do need to blend it with a little bit of water. And this is an alternative to simple syrup, which is the sweetening agent in most cocktails, and that is equal parts sugar and water. And here we're just playing around with maple syrup. I like to play around with maple syrup as well as an alternative sweetener, but we have honey right over here. Okay, so that is great. I have my honey syrup already prepared. Now let's go ahead and start building our drink. So I'm just going to try to angle this forward a little bit so that you can see my workspace. There we go. Right over there. Good. So we'll go ahead and take our vodka, and I am measuring out 2 ounces of my vodka directly into my mixing glass. There we go. And you'll see I'm adding my liquid in my cocktail shaker first. I'm not adding my ice. Why do I do that? Well, ladies and gentlemen, ice is such an important ingredient in all mixed drinks, right? It provides water for the drink. And it provides a proper temperature for the cocktail. So I want to be able to monitor the rate of the ice dilution in my drink. This is very, we're geeky about this. I geek out about this kind of stuff, right? History and technique as well. Okay, let's go ahead and add our honey syrup. So we are doing 3/4 of an ounce of our honey syrup directly into our mixing glass right over here. I have my lemon over here. So I'm going to cut my lemon in half and I'm going to squeeze, fresh squeeze, half of that lemon directly into my cocktail. So I always use fresh juices in cocktails, ladies and gentlemen, never any prepackaged artificial ingredient, citrus or sour mix or anything like that. Super easy to use anyway. And it's usually less expensive to use real citrus. And now a little bit of seasonal element. I'm adding some apple cider. If you don't have apple cider, you can use regular apple juice. That works really well. And 1 ounce into my mixing glass, just like that. Now we will add the ice and we will shake. And here's another trick. So we want to make sure that we add our ice all the way to the top. If we just shake with our ice halfway, just like that, our drink will actually be warmer and more diluted. It's kind of counterintuitive. That's because ice does not want room to move around. So the less room that the ice has to move around, the colder the drink will be and the less diluted the drink will be. So when we're shaking our cocktail, we pop the top on an angle just like that, flip it around so that the glass is facing on top. I will angle so that you can see all of me while I shake, and you can also see my shaker face. Okay, take note of the shaker face. When we shake for 8 Mississippis. That will give you the proper amount of time for the ice to make that drink perfectly balanced, diluted, and chilled. Okay, everyone ready? We're gonna feel free to unmute so that you can count with me. Let us unmute so we can count 8 Mississippis. Ready, set, here we go. 1 Mississippi, 2 Mississippi, 3 Mississippi, 4 Mississippi, 5 Mississippi, 6 Mississippi, 7 Mississippi, 8 Mississippi. Yes, beautiful. Thank you very much for your participation in that. That's awesome. Okay, so now I have my cocktail glass. So this is a martini glass, or also known as a coupe, right? And I don't know if you all are into sort of BBC and GBH, Victorian programming, Downton Abbey, Bridgerton, all of that stuff. Well, you'll see that they're drinking their champagne, they're drinking oftentimes their cocktails, their mixed drinks out of something like this, coupe. And actually the coupe was literally molded. Here's a little interesting story. I don't know if anyone knows, but the cocktail coupe, which is literally the size of this drink, it's kind of curved, right? Was created several hundred years ago, and it was actually designed to be a model of Marie Antoinette. And this was one of her favorite styles of drink, of glasses. And it was modeled after a part of her anatomy, I'll just say. Okay, so here we go. Let's go ahead and strain our cocktail into our coupe glass, or sometimes we call it actually a Marie Antoinette glass. I love cocktail history too, as you probably can tell. I have my lemon. I'm going to slice a thin lemon wheel to just lay flat on top, because no cocktail is complete without a garnish. A garnish should make the drink look pretty, but also add a flavor to the cocktail as well. I'm going to say cheers to you. If you have something in front of you, awesome. Let's just say cheers. I'm going to take a little sip. It's good. It's nicely balanced. It has some really great apple elements, citrus, and the vodka. Of course, you could use gin if you want. You could also use tequila, rum, whiskey in the same cocktail itself. You may be wondering what this is. This is the Mr. Boston Bartender's Guide, a very well-known cocktail book from the 1930s. It has gone through about 30 or 40 different editions. And they asked me 8 or 9 years ago to do the 75th anniversary edition. So that's what this is. It's a really great cocktail book, great gift. You could actually, well, I think Dawn typed in the chat, my website, thecocktailguru.com. You can go to my store on the Cocktail Guru page and get a copy of that signed, and I will send it to you straight to your door. I wanted to quickly mention before I go, ice. So we did not start using ice in mixed drinks and in, well, preservation of food until the early 1800s. And you may or may not know, but this is a really fun story. The one gentleman in particular created something called the frozen water trade. Yes, Frederick Tudor was his name. He made millions of dollars off of this. This is what he had, the bright idea to go to the Berkshire Mountains, the frozen lakes during the wintertime, chop off blocks of ice and cart them onto horse-drawn carriages to the big cities, Boston, New York, New England, and sell it for use in drinks and refrigeration. We were only drinking, before then, we were drinking our drinks at room temperature or warm. So this was a novelty. This was brand spanking new. Frederick Tudor made millions of dollars internationally on his frozen water trade. So cheers to the History Happy Hour. Cheers to the Roach Jones Duff House. Thank you so very much, Dawn, for having me. And hopefully we'll be able to do this in person post-pandemic.
Well, cheers to that. Thank you, Jonathan. And I'm sure everyone appreciated that and wants what you have right in front of you rather than whatever they've mixed at home even. So that was awesome. Great. So I am going to do a little screen share, if you just bear with me, because now starts the drinking part and the history part. So you may get cozy at home with if you did make the cocktail along with Jonathan. He's going to be at the next two History Happy Hours as well. So you'll have to tune in because he'll have a new cocktail for us every time. So I'm going to share an image from the museum's collection next. And you all, somebody confirm that you can see a dog when I do that. Okay, I'm seeing a dog, I hope. Just give me a thumbs up or somebody, yes, if you're seeing a dog. Great, okay. So I'm gonna tell you a little bit about the image that inspired the rest of the presentation tonight. So this is a painting in the Roach Jones Duff House and Garden Museum. It is by the American artist Alexander Pope Jr. You might know that name as a writer, but he was also a different gentleman named Alexander Pope was a painter. And this is from 1889, as you can see. You can see his signature clearly at the bottom. So that's pretty clear attribution there for this St. Bernard dog that we have. So this is an oil on canvas, and it was donated to the museum. October 1st, 1986 was the accession date. The two donors were Roach descendants. So I believe they were brothers, Peter and Lyman Bullard, and they donated this painting to the museum. Actually, I should say that most of our collections come to us through donations. So we're very lucky to have generous donors. This painting was not in the museum, not in the households of the Roaches, Joneses, or Duffs necessarily. But it would have been contemporaneous as an 1889 painting. It would have been contemporaneous with the Jones era when the Jones family was living here. Since you can't tell from the slide, it's 34 inches by 32 inches wide. It's framed in a simple frame in gold. And I'm just going to tell you a little bit about the artist before I let Jamie really take over, because the reason we're looking at this is because she chose it. So the series of History Happy Hours this spring is about a community member choosing a piece in our collection. And I will be giving a little bit of background, but we really are here to hear what Jamie has to say about this painting, why she chose it. So a little bit about Alexander Pope, and he is a junior. He was born in 1849 in Dorchester, Mass. So he's really a Massachusetts resident his whole life. Passed away in 1924. He studied with a painter you might have heard of, William Copley, just briefly, and he studied sculpture rather than painting with that artist. He's mostly self-taught as a painter. And the relevant part of his work for this talk is a series of chromolithographs, which just means color lithographs, and lithographs are a kind of print. Litho, stone, the print is made by etching on stone. So he not only did paintings of dogs like this, he did a whole series of celebrated dogs of America. That was the name of the portfolio of chromolithographs that he produced in 1882, which is obviously prior to this painting. So this painter is basically an animal painter. And that's why, I mean, I have an art background, an art history background. So I looked at this artwork and thought, you know, it's very nicely done. It's somewhat sentimental. If you wanted a portrait of your own animal, This might be a nice, this was a very nice treatment of a dog. You can see a collar on him or her. So let's just look at, there's the signature and he signs it Alex Pope rather than Alexander. But then when we go to the backside, and this is special museum, behind the scenes museum stuff, because you're not allowed to look at the backs of paintings, but here's what it looks like. This is painted by Alexander Pope, 1889. I do not know if that is a signature by Alexander Pope or just somebody who owned the painting writing that in there. So I don't have a lot more background on this piece. So so again, this is an artist known for his animals, and I'll show you a piece from that Celebrated Dogs of America portfolio. What a portfolio was for artists was a kind of a showcase of their work. And I hope you're looking at the back of the painting now and not just the same dog. So hopefully everyone can see Jack Russell Terriers. This is the chromolithograph. That's what one looks like. And this was at an auction site in 2016 for about $650. Because works on paper are never valued as much as paintings. So anyway, just a little tidbit from what I could find out about Mr. Pope. So his series of Celebrated Dogs of America would have been like a showcase of his work, specifically working on animals. And if you were a person of means that wanted a painting for your own house, you might even say, oh, I like this style here. Can you make me one of those or make me something like that? It was almost like a catalog at the same time, a catalog for people to kind of shop from. And I will give a plug now, this is a nice transition to the art museum. Since Jamie is from the art museum, I'm gonna give her a formal introduction next, but the art museum has shown a portfolio from John James Audubon. Same idea, if you're a local and you saw that portfolio, then same idea. This was a series of, I believe, you know, he did a fowl series, and I'll let Jamie talk more about that. Owned by the library, conserved by the art museum, displayed by the art museum. I hope I'm correct in that. So same idea, portfolios of artists. So I'm gonna just show you, he also did sculpture, and this is, the resolution's not so great, but again, an animal. He did a lot of fowl, and this is a three-dimensional piece set on a wood background. So he's much more known for his, I shouldn't say he's much more known, but he did do a lot of sculpture and did get more commissions for his sculpture than painting. So we are very lucky to have his piece here at the Art Museum. I mean, I'm transitioning to Jamie at the RJD. And let me just tell you a little more about Jamie, because she's going to take it over shortly. She is the curator at the New Bedford Art Museum Artworks. We work a lot with the Art Museum here. They're great people over there. I'm gonna put a bunch of links for the Art Museum in the chat, so check them out. When she's not at the Art Museum, Jamie is a performing artist who has exhibited nationally and internationally at venues in New York, Los Angeles, Finland, and Germany. Her work was included in the 2013 Decordova Biennial at the Decordova Sculpture Park and Museum. She has also performed and exhibited at Art Basel Miami, Florida, the Institute of Contemporary Art Boston, the Carpenter Center for the Visual Arts at Harvard University, Rhode Island School of Design Museum, and the Museum of Art and Design in New York. Jamie's work has been published in print, online, video journals such as Headmaster Magazine, Gaga Stigmata, Big Red and Shiny, and Aspect, the Chronicle of New Media Art. So I'm going to spotlight Jamie, and actually she's already spotlighted, so I'm gonna let her take it over. Don't forget to unmute.
Hi, can you hear me? Good, okay, cool. Okie dokie, so thank you, Dawn, for that intro to the dog portrait, and thanks to Jonathan for showing us some cocktail stuff. I was like, every time, you know, he did something cool with the cocktail, I just sort of took a sip, and so now I'm like nice and warm on the inside, so thank you for that. what I wanted to do was not only talk or touch base a little bit about the piece in the RJD's collection, but also think about strategies for looking at artwork and making personal and intellectual and emotional connections to artwork. Because that's kind of our jam at, you know, in the museum field, is helping people connect. And what a better way to do so like than with a picture of a dog. You know, and another thing is that the museum has done, this is kind of a shameless plug, but we did do a show about pets. When my boss Ashley was hired, she was coming from Worcester, who did a cat show, and she suggested that we do, you know, some sort of animal show. And we came to the conclusion to do a show about like people's pets and their feelings. And this is sort of the crux of what I want to talk about. So let's talk about looking at artwork. So one of the ways I like to approach looking at artwork, whether it's a portrait of a dog or the three contemporary works that I'm going to show you, there's this thing called visual thinking strategies. And because it's History Happy Hour, we're just going to call it visual drinking strategies for now. So every time, I don't know, every time you feel like you're learning something new, go ahead and take a sip of your soda or equally attractive alcoholic beverage. Okay, so I'm going to share my screen with you. Give me a hot second here. Share. Okay. So can you guys see my presentation?
Yes.
Thanks. You know, and clearly I'm in a mood, right? This is, as I was looking at the contemporary works I wanted to show you guys, I was like, cool, this is all about death, but we'll get there. Now, the first, I would be remiss to not bring up William Wegman when talking about dog portraiture. You might recognize William Wegman's work from like Sesame Street. He takes a lot of photographs of his Weimaraners dressed up as people. But my favorite work of Will Wegman's, and we're definitely not on a first name basis, so I should call him William, but we'll just say Will, why not? One of my favorite works, some of my favorite works are his early works. His works where, it's the 1970s, camcorders are just becoming available for individuals. And he had moved to Los Angeles, or Long Beach technically, and had got his first dog. And then from that point on, his dogs tend to make, more than appearances, like his dogs are a focal point in his art practice. So a little bit about Will Wegman, and then we'll talk about some visual thinking, drinking strategies. And then I'll show you a quick video of Will Wegman's. So another reason why I wanted to talk about Will Wegman is that he is originally from Massachusetts. He's from Holyoke. He got his BFA at Mass Art, I believe. So, you know, at the Art Museum, we really like to make local connections to things. He is still a working artist. He works out of New York, I believe. And the only reason why I can say that with confidence is because one time, my friend Lonnie and I were walking through the streets of New York City. We saw some Weimaraners, and like a sort of like disheveled looking man holding the Weimaraners. And we just like went straight for the dogs, started petting the dogs, and started freaking out about how those were William Wegman dogs. And then the quiet, disheveled man says to us, "I'm Will Wegman, that's me." And we looked up at him, and sure enough, it was him. And then we freaked out. So he still has his dogs. He spoke to us at length about his dogs. So Will Wegman, he has a variety of dogs now, like of dogs now. He has a couple different ones, But my understanding is that they're coming from the same line of dog. So this is the original Man Ray was the name of this dog. And Man Ray, that was a lie. Man Ray was his first dog. And then his second dog was, I think, called Fay Ray. And then the dogs he has now are spawns of Fay Ray. So that's a little bit about him and his dogs. So visual thinking strategies. This is what we do. When I show you this William Wegman video, the first thing I want you to sort of plant in your brain is what is going on in this video? Like, and get real stupid about it. Like, you don't have to be digging in deep about, you know, what potential feelings are happening. You can just straight up list off what you're seeing. Are you seeing a dog? Are you seeing a man? Are you just like very simple things? It's important when we're looking at art that we break down, our experience with the artwork using our senses. So what do you see? What are some things you feel? Does anything stand out? All right, so we're gonna watch the first video. Are you guys ready? The slide advanced and I didn't want that. Okay, hold on one moment here. Oop.
Try like an arrow up or just start okay. Over.
Yeah, sorry, I was like, I'm just gonna screen share. All right, and we'll just go to desktop since this is my desktop, only sort of embarrassing. Okay, here we go. So the first video we have, where are you? Sorry guys, I had it all queued up and then it disappeared. Well. All right. How about we screen share again?
I can pull it up on my end. Oh, that looks like it.
Can you see it? Yeah.
Yep, we got it.
Now, next question, can you hear it?
Man Ray?
Yes, we can.
Man Ray? Man Ray?
Man Ray?
Man Ray?
Man Ray?
Man Ray? Man Ray? Man Ray!
Man Ray! Man Ray!
Man Ray was born in Philadelphia in 1890, but when he was 7, he had to move to New York. He loved it. He was constantly painting and drawing. High school was painful, except for his art classes, and he was also interested in architecture. When he was 9 months, he was forced to attend a strict obedience school in Santa Monica, California. And that was really important to learn the fundamentals of behavior because the beach was 2 main streets away. At the Francesco Ferrer Social Center, where he attended night classes, Man Ray was allowed greater freedom. His closest friends, besides Bill and Gail at the time, were Picabia and Marcel Duchamp, Jim and Judy, Gary, Teddy, perhaps Ralph.
Go see Teddy. You want to go see Judy? You want to go see Gail? You want to go see Ralph? Who's Ralph? I don't know.
Want to go see Bill?
How about Gary? Man Ray?
Man Ray!
The controversial Armory Show of 1913, which introduced avant-garde European art to America, encouraged Man Ray.
Man Ray.
It confirmed the general direction he had already undertaken. To break away from his home life in order to work without disturbances with the older painter Samuel Halpert, Man Ray found a house with a large number of rooms in Ridgefield, New Jersey. He loved it, he was constantly painting and drawing. The trip across country was really pretty boring, except for the Grand Canyon. There he met, and a year later married, Donna LaCroix. It was perfect while it lasted. In 1975, Man Ray moved back to New York to a studio on Crosby Street. They were building the Lexington Avenue subway opposite Grand Central, beneath his new studio. This was a time of intense Dada activity in New York by the French expatriates. In 1916, Duchamp entered a urinal. So on July 14, 1921, Man Ray left for Paris. Marcel Duchamp was waiting for him at the station. Exactly 3 years before, Tristan Tzara had read the first Dada manifesto in Zurich. Dada was coming to an end, and surrealism, crystallizing under the poets Breton, Aragon, and Eluard, and the artists Arp, Duchamp, and Max Ernst, would commence with Breton's manifesto 3 years later. Were it not for the Nazi occupation in 1940, Man Ray would have never left France. While Duchamp, Tanguy, Ernst, Dali, and other artists in the same predicament as he found refuge in New York, Man Ray sought out a new frontier, Hollywood. Typically, everything went his way. Quoting from his autobiography, "I had a wonderful time.
I had a wonderful time.
I had a woman, a studio, a car.
I had a house, studio, a woman, car, cow, chickens.
I was born again. I've almost as many lives as a cat."
As a cat. As a cat. Where are the cats? Where are the cats?
When he returned to Paris in 1951, Man Ray received a warm welcome from his friends Picasso and Max Ernst. Teddy was bitten by a rattlesnake and later died. Folly passed away. Man Ray passed away in Paris in 1976. Marcel Duchamp was waiting for him at the station.
Okay. Oh, it's starting over. I mean, the internet. There it is. Okay. So if you guys would do me a favor, and if you want, we just are going to practice some visual drinking strategies. So unmute yourselves if you want to participate in this. You can unmute your video too, or you could do neither and I can move on. But one of the things I want to ask you is, what did you see in this video? Anyone?
I saw a lot of humor, or...
Yeah. Anyone else experience some funny stuff?
Yeah, I thought it was funny. I thought it also seemed really modern. Like, you know, just the satire of it.
Describe to me what you mean by modern.
Well, like, I just thought, like, you know how my kids are always showing me videos of people sort of making weird videos.
Yeah. Yeah.
it made me think of that.
Okay, cool. Anyone else? Any other thoughts before I move on to the next video? So now, as I show you the next video, some visual drinking strategies that I want you to do, or think, some things I want you to think about. Again, go back to, what are you actually looking at? What are you actually experiencing? What are you hearing? And then any comparisons between this next video that I show you and the William Wegman video, and then the original painting of the dog in the RJD collection. So the next artist that I'm gonna be showing you guys is a contemporary artist based again out of Massachusetts. Her name is Siobhan Landry. And I am going to show you a video she made in 2011 called Little Tins. And this is really one of my favorites. So let me mute myself and then let's see. And Dawn, let me know if you can hear and see this.
So in my family, when our dogs die, we have them cremated. And then their ashes get put into these little tins with their names on them. The tins are these small things with flowers on them. They look like something you'd find at a gift store, except for the fact that they actually have our dog's ashes in them. We've only done this with the last three dogs that came from Twin Bodine Kennel. Before that, we had another golden retriever. We had Bailey. And when she died, when she got hit by a car, we just buried her in the yard. After Bailey died, that was when we found this kennel, which just has these really beautiful dogs. That's when we got Seamus and Shelby, and initially we were just going to get Seamus. Shelby had been returned to the kennel because she had diabetes. She was supposed to be a show dog, but whoever bought her brought her back. Shelby would run away and Seamus would follow her because he didn't know what else to do with himself. No. Seamus didn't die on one of Shelby's joy runs. What happened is we were walking through the woods and he fell and he came home and his leg hurt, and before we knew it, he died. That was the point when we decided to start cremating our dogs, because it just seemed so heartless to bury a dog like Seamus. Shelby was so sad, but then eventually she started to like us more. So she lasted for a couple more years, and then her liver failed. We had the vet come to the house to put her to sleep. And at that point we had her cremated and put in a little tin, just like Seamus. So when Jameson died, it was really, really sad, and not because he was really young. It wasn't that dramatic. We knew he had cancer. But the reason that it was sad is because my sister's fiance died in one of the towers in 9/11. And then she moved home. You know, she always preferred the company of animals to people. And so one winter, we find out that Jameson has cancer, that it's in his bones. Jameson goes through treatment. He gets a little bit better. We bring him to the ocean. And one day, I'm out throwing rocks for the dog. He's really enjoying himself, and he comes out of the water, and he just sort of collapses right at the edge where the water is sort of like lapping on his body, and he's not moving at all. And I think, oh, God, I've killed Morris Jameson. Eventually he gets up, he's okay, and he walks back home. It's really hard to tell how much pain Goldens are in. They're really very stoic. So anyways, a couple weeks later he dies, and just like with Shelby, a vet comes to the house and puts him under. My father decides that he wants a new dog immediately. So about 2 months later, they go to the same kennel. They go to Twin Bodine Kennel, and they get another dog. And my sister is upset with him. When I see the dog, I start to realize how uncomfortable it is. And then it's even worse. As he gets older, he bears this striking resemblance to Jameson. It's hard not to mix up their names.
Okay, so if you want to unmute yourself and let me know. What did you see? What did you feel? How did it compare to the other two pieces of artwork that we've seen so far?
Well, it wasn't as funny. It was sort of sad, but a loving tribute to dog, to golden retrievers. So it was a nice mix. But you felt happy in the end in some ways.
Yeah,
I found myself wondering, there was the very conscious inclusion of the beeping sound of the camera, you know, counting down to the, it was obviously a camera on a timer, and how she was kind of posing, but like she was obviously, that was all an artist creation. So I'm really I'm more curious about her work now, because she didn't even set up the shots like you would set up a standard portrait where you and the dog would be the whole subject. You know, she made sure she got like these, almost like you're looking into somebody's home, and you shouldn't be, because you see the door and the closet. And so that's what struck me, the whole scenery.
Yeah, other thoughts? Any comparisons to the other two artworks? So here's what we're gonna do. While you guys are thinking about that one, I'm gonna show you one more. It's pretty short. This artist is a musician and collaborated with a couple directors on a massive sort of like music video undertaking. Her name is Tierra Wack. I don't know if you know who she is. She's great. She's super young. She's like 25. And when I saw that, I was like, oh my God. She's been nominated for a Grammy for one of her music videos. The one I'm gonna show you today is just a part of a longer series of music videos called Wack World that are really some of like my favorite pieces of video art out there. So I'm gonna show you one more short video, and then we'll all chat about this work. Yeah, and then we'll close up, okay? Let's see, share screen.
They took my dog away. They treat him like a stray. I talked to God today.
All dogs go to heaven.
I miss my dog.
Heaven.
I kiss my dog.
Heaven.
I miss my dog.
Heaven.
I kiss my dog. My dog had a name. Keep it his name alive. Keep it his name alive.
I'm the one to blame.
If I had to leave,
he would do the same.
Hell on earth,
walking through the flames. Heaven. Heaven.
Ooh, uh-oh, it's still going. Stop it. Okay, so let's all come back together. And chat about what we saw, and let's make some connections. So first thoughts about Tierra Wack's video.
It was upbeat and I really loved it.
What did
love
you
love? The puppets. I love the puppets. I liked kind of the beat of the song, and her personality came through. So I like dance and movement. So it appealed to me. The others did too, but this was cool.
Cool. Anyone else? Thoughts? I'm going to ramble on about some connections that I have between these works. And feel free to just interrupt me if you're like, yeah, I agree, or no, that's crazy. Something that, you know, when Dawn invited me to do this, and we were talking about the dog the dog portrait, I was like, okay, how am I even going to approach talking about this portrait? And one of the ways was thinking about like a dream exhibition that I would do around that portrait. And it turned out like the artists I turned to were three video artists, which is very different than a painting, right? And for me, I think all of the artworks, and this might be me projecting a little bit too much onto the St. Bernard painting, but have kind of hold this humor and this incredible heaviness at the same time. And there's something about the look on the St. Bernard's face. That dog is incredibly stoic looking. But you know, for those of us who are dog owners, there's this, they bring us a lot of joy, and we project a lot of our emotions onto dogs and onto our pets. So that's like the really fascinating part to like all pet art that I'm sort of into. Will Wegman has this very deadpan in his humor, and I would argue that Siobhan is as well. I know that in that that narrative that Siobhan was giving was pretty bleak, but there's some like really funny moments in it too. And since this is like we're doing some visual drinking strategies, I don't know if you noticed that all of her dogs' names were named after whiskeys. You know, and then the Tierra Whack video is a little bit more bouncy, a little bit more fun, but there's still like, you know, it's still puppets in a graveyard. She's still talking about the death of an animal, which is incredibly profound for those of us who have had to put our animals down. One of my favorite things about the portrait of the dog at the RJD is its location, actually. It's a portrait that's hanging in the children's bedroom, which when I think about it within that context, I think of like the dog as a way of sort of like taking care of, or like, you know, like the dog in Peter Pan, who's like the nanny. And so all three of these videos have a bit of like magic to them that I wanted to share with you guys. Tierra Whack is actually from Philly. She's the only sort of non-local. But this, I just wanted to give you a little taste of like contemporary dog art, which I mean, like all these artists are like, I do so much more than dog art, I'm sure. But these are some of my favorites from these contemporary artists.
Hey, Jamie, I have a question for you. Does Tierra Whack do more work with dogs? Like, are these artists like Will in the sense that like they're super dog heavy in what they do? Or are you just kind of selecting works that
great question
team, yeah
so
I love so, them dogs, but I don't know about them that golden retriever thing. I think I'm gonna be sad for the rest of the night now, so thank you.
So I know that Siobhan Landry, you know, I was talking to her before this, and she has a couple of pieces featuring her family's golden retrievers. She just mentioned to me that one of her newest pieces has a dog in it too. I own a couple of Siobhan's photographs, which have dogs in them. So, but Siobhan mainly, like does a lot of like documentary style performance video stuff. Her link is in the chat. It's really, really, I think that she has a way of talking about stuff, very heavy topics with a little bit of, a chuckle. And then Tierra Whack, this one video has to do with dogs, or has to do with pet cemetery, or that's what the video is called. So she doesn't have like a whole lexicon of dog art the way that William Wegman does. Hopefully that answered your question. Any other questions?
You're all welcome to unmute and put on your cameras if you like, and actually, you can also ask, I think Jonathan's still here, if you'd like to ask a cocktail question. I'm sure he'd be happy to answer.
Absolutely.
Jonathan, what's your favorite dog-themed drink? Is it a Greyhound?
Let's connect the two.
It is a salty dog, actually.
What's a salty dog?
It's just a Greyhound, which is vodka and grapefruit juice with a salt rim.
Yeah, that's all I want.
Easy.
I can't believe you had an answer to that question. It's like, of course I have my favorite dog cocktail recipe. Well, I learned the ice thing for me, Jonathan, was a revelation. The ice in the shaker.
Yes.
Never.
I know. That. Well, the thing is when we go out to bars or when we can go out, saddle up to a bar again, you know, I've spent so much time watching bartenders, and the majority of bartenders, when they're making your drink, they're not adding enough ice to your to the cocktail shaker before shaking, and they're not shaking for the right amount of time. So, you know, if you go into a bar and you get a cocktail and you're like, it doesn't taste like this tastes unbalanced, or it tastes like it's warm, or it tastes like it doesn't have enough alcohol in it, it's probably because of those reasons.
Any other questions for our speakers? I want to thank both of our speakers. That was fantastic. And you were able to connect the two, the cocktails to the dogs. Excellent. Jamie even was able to connect her modern contemporary artist to our 1882 painting in the Roach Jones Duff House. Mm-hmm. So amazing. So thank you, everybody, especially our presenters, you know, hand clap. You can give them a digital clap too, if you'd like. I see some of those. And we hope to see you in the future at future History Happy Hours. I remind you that they are unfortunately virtual, but you see how well it works in this kind of format. You can mix your cocktails at home, which I'm not sure we would be able to let you do that here in a museum setting, but thanks so much for joining us, and come back on.